Citizen's Advice, The Making of a Documentary, Episode 5.
Cousin's wedding.
What does?
The creation of the state of Israel in Palestine. It was an arranged wedding. Marvellous ceremony. Imran, that's my second cousin on my mother's side. He didn't want to marry his betrothed. She didn't want to marry him either, but he wanted her dowry. It was a beautiful house full of beautiful things and quite a nice garden with a fountain. The fountain wasn't that beautiful, though. It was a leftover from colonial days. The figure of an angel looking sternly down on you. Anyway, she didn't want to marry him, because she didn't want to marry anyone. An independent girl for those times. But her parents weren't that rich. Her dowry was all they had. But Imran's parents were really powerful, so the marriage went ahead anyway. So Imran got the beautiful house with the beautiful things and the garden and the Naf fountain, but he was stuck with her too. So after this marvellous ceremony, I can't remember what I was wearing. But anyway, after this marvellous ceremony and everyone went home, they were left alone.
And?
Yes?
I can't say. It's unspeakable. It's really shameful.
Oh dear.
She stayed with him for the children.
There's going to be no avoiding this one.
Really, like, loads of years, many years, through many years of suffering. But she had to flee for her life, and she took refuge with her relatives who didn't want her there either. But the children were left with him, whom he hates because they're just like their mother.
I don't think that's the situation David's clients in, though. He's still living in
Israel. Nationality law, 1952. Israeli citizenship is acquired by residence. Person who immediately before the establishment of the state was a Palestinian citizen and who does not become an Israeli national under Section 2 shall become an Israeli national with effect from the day of the establishment of the state if...
Their hands.
What?
Who?
What? Wait a minute. Is that you, Linda? What are you doing in my thoughts?
Don't ask me. They're your thoughts.
This is definitely playing into...
Wait a minute. Is that you, Javad?
Maybe.
OK, what's going on here?
This has got to be special effects, man. There's no way of getting around this one.
What?
Nationality law, 1952, eh? A Palestinian citizen becomes an Israeli citizen after the creation of Israel's state in Palestine. Sounds pretty sound. As it just happens to be your home. But then if you happen to be fleeing for you and your children's life to outside these boundaries and didn't return before 1952, you've lost that citizenship of the place that was your home. Can you imagine that?
Mind you, they had no homes to return to because this new state had taken possession of them.
Oh, yeah?
Or demolished them.
Wait a minute.
Catch 33, David.
I think you mean catch 22.
I think it's worse myself.
Mind you, David, they didn't let them return and still haven't.
Catch 44, then.
Sorry to interrupt, but could I please have my thoughts back?
Is this an analogy?
What?
Do you get analogies in documentaries?
David, are you okay?
What? Well, I don't know. I wonder sometimes if I'm really cut out for this kind of work.
David?
Oh, dear.
Wouldn't it be funny if you turned out to be a Christian?
Would it?
Or a Buddhist?
That's not very likely, though, Zaida.
Oh?
Well, there's not much obesity in that part of the world.
I found the contact details of an animal rights organisation.
I have something I must inform you of.
They are national, but there is a local group.
Can I trust you, Amy?
Everything you tell me, Raoul, is confidential.
The thing is, you see, Emmy, my papa, my father, he was a matador himself. I was taken to attend the ring since I was a baby. I have seen the bulls trying to appear, to pretend that they are not in the ring, snorting and stamping, and the crowd cheering, taunting the bull. The bull tries to express himself with his nose, snorting with disdain, but he has not replied to. He tries to be strong. I am bull, look at me. You cannot hurt me. I am strength itself. I am invisible. But he is not strength itself. He is not. He is flesh and blood and fur and hoof and horn. I remember the first time I saw into the bull's eyes as he saw his fate. I saw a tear appear in his eyes. Yes. I see you do not believe me. A solitary tear ran from his straining pupils. I saw the same look in my father's eyes, and the same tear went...
Is he dead?
Who?
Your father?
No.
What is it you wanted to tell me?
I have kidnapped her.
Who?
Daisy.
Who's Daisy? Oh, you've kidnapped a cow.
I know, Amy, I had to. He would not sell her to me, Mr. Farmer Joslington. I offered him nearly half of all the money I own, but he said no. He questioned me, asked me what I wanted of her, so I told him.
You've stolen a cow.
I had to. I thought he would understand, but...
Where is it?
She.
She? Where is she?
In my caravan.
You've stolen a cow, and you're keeping her in a caravan?
He left me no other choice. She has all the comforts.
Well, where is this, your caravan?
In your car park.
In our car park? A cow in a caravan in our car park?
I have another question about, Emmy, leaving vehicles when a passenger in a car ferry.
A cow. A stolen cow is in a caravan in car ferries?
Yes, Emmy. You like to see her? Come outside with me. You will love her for sure. She is so... No man could kill her. Maybe a woman, but no man could. It is okay. There is plenty of room. I took out the convertible double bed and the card playing table for those wet afternoons. She walks around sometimes. It seems like she is prowling.
Please don't open the window, Mr. Guiza.
Raoul, please. Pardon? Come on. Who is that man in orange?
Let me see.
He's very nosy for an Englishman.
It's Mr. Munro.
Look, there she is, peeking out. Look. Who is this Mr. Munro?
Actually, he's an American gentleman, a regular client. They've got a long-running disrepair dispute with the council about their temple.
What is going on?
Oh, shit.
What kind of world is this?
He's a Narishimari.
This creature should not be in a caravan.
What is he doing? Hey there,
oh,
you!
Oh, such a sacred creature. What? Who are you?
Mr. Munro?
Who's that?
Hello?
Is that you?
Yes, it's me. Amy.
Amy!
Could you come up?
What is going on? There's a cow in a caravan in this car park.
And I'll explain. I'll meet you in reception.
Coming up.
Okay.
Better have a damn good explanation.
Wait, Amy, what are you going to do? I have thrown myself into your mercy today. Please, you...
What am I going to do? Confidentiality. I can't... Unless you give me permission... Raoul, I need to speak to Mr. Munro about your situation, okay? But I'll need your permission.
Well, I forbid you to...
But Mr...
Raoul, please.
Raoul, if I don't talk to Mr. Munro and explain to him this madness, the cow...
Please, Daisy, please.
Daisy is stolen. You've stolen a cow. It's a crime. We don't deal with criminal matters. We can refer you, though. Oh, I need to explain to Mr. Munro... He'll be outraged by a cow in a caravan.
But why?
His religion. I can explain to him that you're trying to liberate the cow.
Daisy.
Daisy.
I am taking her to Belgium.
Hold on, where are they? They're here somewhere. Could you sign this letter of authority? It allows me to talk to other parties on your behalf with regard to your problem. Please, quickly.
I will trust you, but remember why I am doing this. It is for the bulls. Tell your misnamed Nuro, for the bulls.
I'm not so sure this is a good idea. It might be a gender-specific thing with Narishimari, or it might include the bovine species generally. But anyway, please, just sign this. Okay, thank you. I won't be long. If you want to look at the information I got while you wait, and have any questions about... Oh, fuck it!
sorry it's taking so long. No, I'm not. I'm not sorry it's taking so long at all.
Pardon?
Doesn't matter. I just need to ask a few brief questions before I go any further with the charade.
And what would you say, like, bad choice, Ashley?
When you found yourselves homeless, did you apply to be rehoused locally, back home in Israel?
عم يسأل إذا قدم الطلب لإعادة تسكينك أو إعمار بيت في محل تاني.
خبره.
Yes, they applied to a local settlement. It's like a community, but they would not accept them because they do not allow non-Jews to live in settlements.
So you're meant to be an Arab then?
Yes. Is there something wrong?
Is there something wrong? Well, you tell me.
What?
Oh, nothing.
My uncle is an Arab. Here's his Israeli identity card. There, look. Arab.
Oh, yes, of course. An ID card. Of course. Well, we can't argue with a piece of card with a photo on it. And a stamp, of course. Very convincing.
Are you sure everything's okay?
Okay. So, right, where was I? Oh, yes, yes. Was your uncle amongst the 250,000 Palestinians who... Sorry, amongst the 250,000 Palestinian Arabs forcibly removed from their homes in Palestine between December 1947 and May 1948 by the Israeli armed forces?
What?
Oh dear. Haven't you done your research? When I played Dr. Doolittle, there was virtually nothing I didn't know about gynaecology. What's very significant for us at least, trying to establish the circumstances of the demolitions, because that's what we do here, is whether your uncle was outside the boundaries of Israel when it was created.
عمي عم بيسأل إذا الإسرائيليين طردوك بالقوة بين فترة يعني شهر 12/47 لشهر 5/48.
شو؟
بعرف.
لا.
No.
Okay. Was he then amongst the 550,000 Palestinian Arabs forcibly removed from Palestine, ethnically cleansed as it's called today, between 1948 and 1949?
بدي أعرف إذا أنت انطردت عمي من فلسطين وقت النكبة.
أحكي له لا بعد.
Not yet.
نكبة. Well, you've done a bit of research then. Okay. So you were within the borders of what became Israel when it declared independence?
Yes, it was.
Right. Well, I'm popping out again to consult with my colleagues, and I'll be back. I know not when. So if you get bored, you know where the door is. Don't worry about us. We're just information junkies. Can't get enough.
Welcome to Job Centre Plus, part of the Department for Work and Pensions. Please be aware that if you are calling from a mobile or a non-BT landline, you will be charged at the rate set by your service provider. This service is for social fund inquiries and application forms only. Your call may be monitored or recorded for legal and training purposes and to help us improve our services. Please press any key to continue and we will answer your call as soon as...
David.
Right. Enough is enough is enough. So here we go. The client's house was demolished. It was demolished because he's supposed to be, or he is, an Arab. Yes, said the word. Classified in Israeli law as an Arab, it's on his very convincing ID card. The Planning and Building Law, 14th of July 1965, initiated the drawing up of boundaries around localities where Arabs live. That restricted them to a point of clear, well, ghettoising. Know the word for it. Arabs make up 20% of the population, but are restricted to building on just 2% of the land. That's approximate. This then forces the Arab population of Israel to have to build their homes on land they cannot get permission to build on, even though they actually own this land, which is what our client is supposed to have done. So the homes of Arabs in Israel are systematically then demolished.
David, are you feeling okay?
Yes, I'm fine. There's more, you see. The client was restricted from finding alternative accommodation locally again because he is an Arab. The other land available in the area, like 93% of all Israel, is administered by the state, which passed among other laws, the Absentee Property Law of 1950, the World Zionist Organisation Jewish Agency for the Land of Israel Law of 1952, or the Jewish National Fund Law of 1953. I mean, and then there are separate covenants between the government of Israel and the World Zionist Organisation, as well as between the government and the Jewish Agency and the Jewish National Fund. Covenants, I might add, which charter much of the control of the settlement and afforestation of the land administered by the state to these and other Zionist bodies, whose constitution excludes Arabs from building their homes in these settlements, and then they draw up bylaws to exclude them. The odd exceptions in the past 2 to 3 decades, notwithstanding.
Is that the cat out of the bag?
Inhuman acts committed for the purpose of establishing and maintaining domination by one racial group of persons over any other racial group of persons and systematically oppressing them. A. Denial to a member or members of a racial group or groups of the right to life and liberty of person. 1. By murder of members of a racial group or groups. 2. By the infliction upon the members of a racial group or groups of serious bodily or mental harm, by the infringement of their freedom or dignity, or by subjecting them to torture or to cruel, inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. 3. By arbitrary arrest and illegal imprisonment of the members of a racial group or groups. B. Deliberate imposition on a racial group or groups of living conditions calculated to cause its or their physical destruction in whole or in part. C. Any legislative measures and other measures calculated to prevent a racial group or groups from participation in the political, social, economic and cultural life of the country, and the deliberate creation of conditions preventing the full development of such a group or groups, in particular by denying to members of a racial group or groups basic human rights and freedoms, including the right to work, the right to form recognized trade unions, the right to education, the right to leave and to return to their country, the right to a nationality, the right to freedom of movement and residence, the right to freedom of opinion and expression, and the right to freedom of peaceful assembly and association. D. Any measures, including legislative measures designed to divide the population along racial lines by the creation of separate reserves and ghettos for the members of a racial group or groups, the prohibition of mixed marriages among members of various racial groups, the expropriation of landed property belonging to a racial group or groups, or to members thereof. E. Exploitation of... Sorry, I can't remember it all now. the labour of the members of a racial group or groups, in particular by submitting them to forced labour. F. Persecution of organisations and persons by depriving them of fundamental rights and freedoms because they oppose apartheid.
Pardon?
What? I don't think I can repeat that.
No. What is it?
Part of the international covenant on the suppression and punishment of the crime of apartheid, UN 1976.
Wow, Linda. How did you remember all that, Linda?
And why?
Well, there is a very good reason. In my previous life, a life I believe I'm overcoming and making amends for.
Well, you know we're all 110% behind you, Linda.
Well, actually, Javad, there is more to my past than what I was. I used to live in a similar apartheid state to Israel. Harsher in some ways, but not as harsh in others.
New Zealand was an apartheid state. So the all blacks used to literally mean...
No, Javad. Not New Zealand. No. I'm so sorry. I know I should have. I was trying to start again. A break from the past. I grew up. I used to live in South Africa.
But...
Sorry. I'm so sorry. My family moved out to South Africa from England when I was a child. Not New Zealand.
Wow. So all this time you've been putting on that accent?
It's in the past. It's all part of my past.
You have been living a bit of a fib.
Yes. I was afraid of what people would think. I have lived two lies in my life. One, because I feared how people would treat me because of what I am. And one, because of what I have done.
But Linda, there's nothing to be ashamed of. Many good people lived in... It's not your fault your parents took you over there.
But the truth is, Javad, I worked for the state. The apartheid state. I worked for the police. I have done things you would not understand. I've done things to people you would not forgive. You got to understand, you see, when I was trying to be a man, I tried so hard to be what I wasn't. I didn't know I was trying. I thought that's just how life was. Just one trial after another. Always trying to prove who I wasn't. I tried everything to deny, to be, to escape who I am. I was cruel to myself and to others. I have tried to make up for it. I know maybe I never will, but I've committed my life to try. And now you know, and now all of Leeds and Bradford know. But I'm not going to hide. If I can face people knowing I'm a woman that was trapped in a man's body, I can face people knowing that I'm a humanitarian that was trapped in help me out here.
Trapped in a fascist thug's heart?
In a racist's mind?
A humanitarian that was trapped in an apartheidist, is that a word? Linda!
Excuse me.
Oh, sorry, David. Did that just happen? All these years? Sorry. Go on, David.
Our client?
Right. Yes, of course. Your client. Client.
The demolition of our client's house is legal within the laws of Israel. But these laws and practices are illegal in international law. Coincidentally, of apartheid. Israeli apartheid.
Well, it could have been a lot worse.
Oh?
She could have turned out to be Australian.
I've lied to the job seekers allowance people.
Take a seat.
I didn't mean to.
Oh.
Honestly, you've got to believe me. Do you believe me?
Well...
If you don't believe me, does that mean you won't help me?
Whether I believe you or not doesn't affect me advising you. It may just alter what I may advise you.
Really? So I could tell you a pack of lies? So I could tell you a pack of lies and you would still help me?
In a manner of speaking, yes.
So I could tell you that I've won the lottery and my boyfriend has run off with a winning ticket and you would still help me?
That would be a criminal matter, which we don't deal with.
Anyway, I'm not lying to you. Or them. No, I did lie to them.
Oh.
I lied to them.
Hmm.
No. Yes, I lied to them. They'd have to believe me, wouldn't they, first? If they don't believe me, is that it? If they don't believe me, is that all they have to do? Not believe me.
When you say you didn't mean to...
I'm not sure what to do. What can they do to me? Can they put me in prison? I didn't mean to. They've been writing letters to me.
Did you bring them with you?
I was in their office signing in. On, you know. Do you know? Have you ever... Not that I mean anything by that.
Mm-hmm.
Have you? Signed on. Not now.
Well,
I'm nosy, aren't I? Mm-hmm. Don't mean anything by that, by the way. I'm not trying to say anything. Anyway, and the man was looking at me, who was signing me, you know, taking my signature, and asking me about what I've been doing, you know, how I've been searching for a job searching. He was staring at me.
Right.
Looking at me.
Looking at me.
This. Oh. Really? Looking at me. He asked me about how I am searching and then said nothing for ages and just looked at me.
Looked at me.
Yeah.
The letters you received, have you brought them with you?
What letters?
The letters you received from the Job Seekers Allowance people.
You know about them? Are you part of the government?
No.
Is this being recorded?
Yes. No, I mean, we are not part of the Department of Work and Pensions, OK?
Oh, my. What have I said? Can I listen back to what I've said so far? Can I?
Didn't you sign an agreement to be recorded for the documentary?
Yes, I did. Earlier. I did, yes. This woman who was smiling and...
Did they explain to you what it was for?
Yes, they did. And then I signed it.
So you know it's for a documentary that's going to be broadcast on the radio?
Yes, I do know that it's being recorded for a documentary that's going to be broadcast on the radio. Yeah.
So are you sure you want to go continue?
That's your opinion. Option. Is there an option?
You could ask them to switch the microphone off and continue with the interview.
Really?
Yes, it wouldn't be any trouble.
They won't be able to broadcast it, though, then. Then?
No, they wouldn't be able to broadcast it then, though. Though they wouldn't mind. I'm sure they're recording other interviews to broadcast. I mean, they'll have enough.
I don't know. I just need to tell you. I don't know what to do. I lied to them. I honestly didn't mean to, honestly. I'm not lying to you. Though I know I could lie to you and appreciate it, thank you. There is no way you can go and lie. No, you go to a priest and you're meant to tell the truth. Shrinks, you're meant to tell the truth. There's nowhere.
Truth.
I'm glad I came here. Thank you for letting me. I'm not lying. I'm not. But I did lie to the Job Seekers Allowance people. I told them I had been working and I haven't.
What?
I know. I don't know. It was the way he was looking at me. I didn't want to say I hadn't been. I could see him expecting me to say no. So I said yes. He looked so pleased. So I went along with it. And now, I have won the lottery and I'm going to end up in prison. I haven't eaten for days. How many? I'm not sure. I think my boyfriend is going to chuck me for someone else. The wife's got a job, I think. He believes her anyway.
What?
No, I'm only kidding. I'm just pulling your leg. Going along with kidding you. Sorry. I bet your job's hard enough about people like me, eh?
Sahida played by Mez Galeria, David played by David Peel, Stella and Maeve played by Eleanor Oxbury Breakwell, Linda and Clients played by Steve Arloff, Javad played by Sadiq Akbar, Amy played by Libby Wattis, Gusov played by Morabi. Walid played by Mohammed Al-Jarrah. Carol and Clients played by Catherine Holden. Written by Jeff Find. Foley sound design and mixing Samuel Stocks and Beach Pilkington. Editing Samuel Stocks. Original music by Athol Ransom. Thanks to Tim Peck. Waiting music. Shostakovich's Hamlet, Opus 116. Special thanks to Professor Uri Davis for support and advice, and Reem Kalani for extracts from the album Sprinting Gazelle. Special thanks to Millpond Studios, Hebden Bridge.